Our opening words this morning are from Nancy Schaefer, from a piece titled, "Were I to Teach a Course on God." Were I to teach a course on God, I would begin with a plate of persimmons, the sweet, crisp kind, the ones more orange than red, the hard, squat fuyus I eat each November morning on hot wheat cereal with almonds. I would slice the persimmons gently across their fat centers and then hold them out. See the star shape? I would offer them so all might wonder. I would slice brown bosque pears straight down their middles so that the threads of each stem trace wispily down to that rounded place where the dark seeds lie tear-shaped and wet in the white firm flesh. I would hold those halves silently forward, their bottoms smooth in the curves of my palms. I would teach God with plates full of pomegranates, both before they were opened and after. And I would bring wet washcloths, and we would bury our faces and eat all that luminescent purple-red, those clear, bright kernels fitted into tight rows on small and tumbling hills, and all that juice, so easily broken, sweet and puckery at once, we would say nothing. I would teach this way, with plates of fruit and a knife and many washcloths, with my eyes very large and my mouth mostly silent, so that all might have a chance to eat.
Alex. We light this chalice to affirm that new light is ever waiting to break through to enlighten our ways. And that new love is ever waiting to break through to warm our hearts.
There we go. I have some things to share with our young people. If there is anyone young of heart and young of knee, and maybe fairly short still, who wants to come up? All right. We have a whole lot of holidays kind of happening all at once this year. And some of them are apple holidays. So we're going to talk about that. The first holiday kind of happened yesterday and today. And that's this big celebration called the People's Climate Walk, or the People's Climate March, which happened here in Santa Fe yesterday and which is happening in New York City later today, which is about people from all faiths and people from all walks of life coming together to tell our government that we really do need to protect our planet. And it's a wonderful and curious time for that to happen because of two other holidays that are going on just in the next few days. Tomorrow is the autumn equinox. So tomorrow is the day when the amount of daytime and the amount of nighttime are exactly the same, and that's why we have our Wheel of the Year here, sitting up here, and it goes from spring to summer through autumn and then back into winter, and so that's the star wheel from the song. Now, also in the middle of that, there's a basket of apples. And in the pagan tradition, kind of like in the poem this morning that I started with, you cut an apple at autumn equinox or any other time right across the center, and when you open it, you see the star. And in the pagan tradition, the five-pointed star is the symbol of that faith, just the way the chalice, the flaming chalice, is the symbol of ours. And the points stand for earth, air, fire, water, and spirit. And so that connects it to what we grown-ups are going to talk about later in the day. Now, the other holiday that's coming up also uses apples for something very special. And that holiday starts on Thursday night. And it's a holiday that is very dear to our Jewish brothers and sisters. It's Rosh Hashanah and the beginning of the High Holy Days, which end in
What?
What do the High Holy Days end in?
I don't remember.
Oh, Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur.
Right.
Right. And one of the things, Rosh Hashanah is the birthday of the world in the Jewish tradition. It is the celebration of that Genesis story of creation. And we are to celebrate a sweet new year by eating apples. So I have slices of apple. If you guys each, if you kids each want to take a slice of apple and eat it while I keep talking, you can do that. Oh, okay. Vivian is telling me that National Talk Like a Pirate Day was Friday. That is another important holiday. And there is another input. Today is International Peace Day. And Miss Alice will tell you more about that. She is wearing her peace crane earrings today in honor of International Peace Day. One of the fun things about Unitarian Universalism is we get to celebrate as many holidays as we want to. Now, Rosh Hashanah through the High Holy Days to Yom Kippur is a holiday the rest of us might want to think about too. And so I have a challenge for each of you, kids and adults, between now and next Sunday. The important part of Rosh Hashanah, the High Holy Days, and Yom Kippur is that this is a holiday where you reconstitute your community. You put it back together where it's frayed at the edges. And the way you do this is between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, you're charged with finding anyone whose feelings you have hurt during the year. Anyone who you've gotten crosswise with, anyone you have offended, and you're supposed to apologize to them and make things better so that this sweet new year that we're celebrating is really sweet because we're able to be on the same page together once again. And so my challenge to you is between now and next Sunday to find one person that you got crosswise with this year and to apologize to them and to make it right. And that's a challenge for the kids, but it's also a challenge for the rest of us. All right. Well, Lashana Tova, may you guys have a sweet new year. Let's sing you on your way. Thank you. This is the third in several services where we're exploring Peter Richardson's adaptation of the Myers-Briggs types and how that pertains to worship. And since this is the Sunday where we are exploring sensing feelers and the path of devotion, we rearranged just a couple of things to, I hope, feed those of you who identify as sensing feelers a little more than we do some other Sundays. And so this morning, as our music plays, we invite anyone who wishes to come forward, light a candle in silence, and then record your joys and sorrows in the book to my left. Now, you don't have to write anything down. You're also invited to just come forward and light a candle if that speaks to your heart. Thank you. Let's move into a time of quiet and contemplation. I invite you to close your eyes if you're comfortable closing your eyes. And to take a deep breath and to let it out. And as you let that breath out, to blow away any anxiety or tension or worry that you might be carrying. Just breathe in the air and let out all that stress. And let your body and your breath start to relax. As you settle into the quiet, let your thoughts drift like the beautiful clouds in our New Mexico sky. And feel your heart begin to unclench. Feel it begin to soften and to open. Breathe. And let your attention spiral inwards. Breathe again. And let yourself rest in the safe and spacious place at the very core of your being. Feel yourself surrounded by this caring community and let yourself be held. Amen, and blessed be.
Our first reading is from Thomas More, Care of the Soul. In our spirituality, we reach for consciousness, awareness, and the highest values. We endure the most pleasurable and the most exhausting of human experiences and emotions in our soulfulness. These two directions make up the fundamental pulse of human life. Our second reading is from Peter Richardson, Four Spiritualities. People on the journey of devotion are sensitive, friendly, loyal, and caring. They are likely to marry, have children, and live responsibly as parents and citizens. In neighborhoods and congregations, they are the ones who initiate bringing a meal to the family of a sick person or who send flowers when a child is born or an elder dies. They are devoted to serving others in direct, tangible, personal ways.
So, just these are the two books, in case you wondered what we were citing from, and I'm going to be referring to them throughout the service. So they'll be up here on the table if you want to look at them later. So yesterday, I think there were maybe 20 of us in yellow t-shirts and a number of others in other shades of t-shirt who gathered with 500 of our closest friends down on the plaza. We were there for the People's Climate March, and the sun, as is typical in New Mexico, was very hot. And the shadows were absolutely chilly. And the sky was that intense New Mexico blue, and the jazz band played every time we traveled from one site to the next. And it felt like it was part carnival, and part pilgrimage and part parade. It was connected to something bigger because it was connected to this climate march that's happening today in New York City. And there were climate walks all over the country in different places this weekend, all asking and praying and arguing that our government ought to be doing more to support the health and well-being of this planet that we call home. The march was in service to a great big idea, but it was also very specific to Santa Fe. I mean, it was our spaces and our government and our people who were there and our band. Carpooling down with friends, standing with colleagues, walking with the congregation made the event both personal and global, intimate and large at the same time. There was room for spirit, there was also room for soul. Thomas More suggests that in the very broadest sense, we can understand spirituality or the idea of spirit as an aspect of any attempt to approach or attend to the invisible factors in life and to transcend those things that are personal, concrete, and finite particulars. When we talk about spirituality in that way, as something which is transcendent and abstract, we're really talking about the native spiritual path of the Myers-Briggs intuitive thinker. It's lofty, it's abstract, and it's symbolic. Now, you'll remember from earlier conversations that the Myers-Briggs type indicator sorts people's psychological preferences on four different scales, from introversion to extroversion. You fall somewhere on that scale in your preferences. From intuition to sensing, from thinking to feeling, and from judging or liking closure to perceiving and wanting things always to be open-ended. This is the third in a series of sermons based on Peter Richardson's work, and he uses only the two central scales, the intuition to sensing and the thinking to feeling scale. And he says when you look at these, it gives you information about how people might best feed their own spiritual sensibilities, okay? He says we're not all alike. And we have a tendency to think that everybody experiences the mysterious or the holy or the community in the same way, and that they all experience it the same way we do. And really, that's not true at all, as we'll see this morning. So last time we examined the spiritual path of the intuitive thinkers, people who use their intuition to read between the lines as a way of gathering information, and then who use their reason and logic to sort that information to make meaning. That's one way of engaging the world. This morning, we're going to look at the path of folks who gather their information through their senses, through their hands and their tongues and their eyes and their ears, and make sense of it through the lens of their emotions and their relationships. These are the sensing feelers, and Richardson calls their path the path of devotion. It's a path which celebrates the person and the tangible, relational, and sensuous aspects of living in the world. And I would offer to you, in Thomas More's language, that this, if the intuitive thinkers are a path of the spirit, lofty and abstract, then the sensuous feelers, the path of devotion, is a path of the soul, concrete, particular, loving and forgiving. Before we go very far down that path, I want to orient you a little bit more to what sensing and feeling are in Jungian and Myers-Briggs type language. Sensing feelers engage the world through their senses and make sense of the world through their feelings. So these are the folks for whom we have the yellow seats, which are our fragrance-free zone. These are the folks who would notice if someone is wearing perfume and sitting next to them. These are the folks who can tell at a taste that something is perfectly ripe or something's gone over just a little bit. These are the folks who attend to the physical, kinesthetic, tactile, olfactory, auditory, and visual aspects of what's actually there. Okay? You'll remember the intuitive thinkers, you sort of give them a hint and they go off into this internal world about which, you know, the symbols. So the intuitive thinker will say, oh yes, that's the wheel of the year, and that means, and they go off on a reverie about what the wheel of the year might mean. The sensing feeler will look at the wheel of the year and they'll say, oh, she has chrysanthemums on it this year. And I wonder if those are gala apples or if they're Fuji's, and I wonder if they're organic or not. And they're galas and they are organic, just so you know. But the sensing types are really interested in what's actually there. Now, the sensing feelers are not only interested in what's actually there, they're interested in who else is there and how they are. So all sensors are interested in facts of the matter, but sensing feelers are interested in the facts of how it's going with all of these other people that I care about. Okay? Sensing folks who attend to the details and logistics and flavors of shared experience make up about 75% of the population. That's a lot of people who engage the world first and foremost through their senses. Now, once they have this information gathered through their senses, the feelers are going to process that information through their emotions and their relationships. Unlike the thinkers who are going to apply reason and sort for truth, what's true here, the feelers are going to apply their emotions and they're going to sort for what feels right. They're going to sort for what will support my relationships, what will make our community healthier. They're sorting for connection and for harmony. People who make sense of the world through their emotions represent about 50% of the population. This one's a pretty even split, with a little bias in our culture, with a few more women weighing in as feelers and a few more men weighing in as thinkers, and no one's quite sure how much of that's a cultural artifact. But what we do know is that it sometimes makes it difficult for men who identify as feelers to claim their emotions as a way of making sense of things. And conversely, for women who process the world but with thinking to claim that as where they stand. So when you take the two together, the sensors and the feelers, and combine them, that particular combination is about 38% of the population, as compared to the intuitive thinkers who are about 12% of the population. So that's a lot of sensing feelers who are out there. And so it shouldn't be surprising that within the world's religions, there are a lot of practices that actually are designed or evolved to feed people who interact with the world through their senses and their emotions. And Richardson talks about 8 of them, and I'm going to give you a little summary here. And they'll probably flow together because the 8 are very connected. So to begin with, people who have an SF, a sensing, feeling, spirituality, or soulful practice, are rooted in stories. Stories are hugely important, and stories of many kinds. There are hero stories that get told, and stories about ancestors. There are stories that get enacted in rituals, like the Passover Seder or the Las Posadas. There are stories that get attached to recipes that got handed down, or artifacts, and stories that connect us to the people who taught us about those things. In a sensing, feeling, spirituality, stories provide a narrative arc about what's going to happen, but they also establish and maintain a set of relationships that give life and action their meaning. Now, this is really different from the way that the intuitive thinkers relate to story. Intuitive thinkers look for the metaphor. You know, they're scanning for how this describes something that's intangible. The sensing feelers look for the relationship. What is this story telling me about how to be in relationship with the world, with the people I care about, with the mystery of all existence? Now, saints and heroes often play an important part in these stories, as much as or more than ancestors or older relatives do. Characters in story, especially the protagonists in the stories and their allies, offer sensing feelers real characters to love and to emulate. They take something that's very abstract, this notion of whatever the mystery is, whatever the right way to live in the world is, and they put it in human bodies and they offer tangible, practical ways of relating to that mystery by relating to other people. So they make, through stories, they make the numinous approachable. And they allow the sensing feeler then to identify with the hero or to embody some of that larger mystery. When you take that hero's journey, that story, and you enact it, whether it's in a pilgrimage or in a Passover Seder or in a ritual, something really interesting becomes possible. Because the individual is stepping into the story and embodying the characters. So you have this visceral, lived sense of what is happening in this narrative that's been passed down to you. And so think about our colleagues here in Santa Fe who make the pilgrimage to Chimayo during Holy Week at Easter time, and who do it with that big, heavy cross on their shoulders. They're not doing that just because it's something you're supposed to do. And they're not doing it because they're gluttons for punishment. They're doing it because by doing that, you physically step into the story and have the opportunity to identify with what it was like, to identify with how Jesus suffered, to come closer through this physical lived experience to your understanding of God. This embodied practice turns on its ear one of the ways we Unitarian Universalists often think about theology. Because what we like to do most of the time is we like to think about what we're going to do and have our thought shape our ritual and our practice. Within an SF kind of spirituality, we reverse that. And you step into the practice and you let your experience in the practice shape what you think and feel, shape your theology. So your body and your experience shape your theology rather than your reason theology shaping the ritual with which you're going to engage. Now, on a smaller scale, maybe less dramatic, we can think of it as the practice of saying grace at meals or keeping a gratitude journal. The experience of doing that eventually over time shapes our thankfulness for what's going on in our lives. So it can be big rituals or it can be little rituals. But this notion that what we do could shape how we think is an important gift that SF thinkers and feelers bring to our community. Now, for a practice to have a deep shaping effect on us, it helps if the activities that we undertake are already pretty well vetted. You know, going off and adopting some experimental new thing that you just invented last week as your spiritual practice isn't going to have the same kind of impact on you because it's harder to trust. You're better off trusting something that you've seen other human beings deriving benefit from for centuries and centuries. And so if you go and sit on the mountain for 3 days fasting and asking for insight into how you should live the rest of your life, you can do that knowing that that is a pan-religious practice. People in faith traditions all over the world have used fasting and solitude as ways of unlocking their own inner wisdom and speaking to what they understand as the holy. On a smaller scale, the roots of the experience, the depth of the experience can shape us as well. And I want to offer that saying your table grace, the same grace that your grandfather or great-grandfather or grandmother said, in the same language that your grandmother or grandfather said it, has a different resonance in your life, perhaps, than saying a new grace you made up every evening. Likewise, there are Unitarian Universalist churches who keep full sets of the red or blue hymnals that are only brought out at Christmas time because those are the ones that have the correct lyrics to all of the Christmas carols. And by golly, we want to sing the old words even when we no longer agree with the theology. Somehow there's that heart connection to the words and the melodies and the memory that is there, even when the intellect is kind of spitting a little bit at having to sing those other words. When I sit with people who are dying, I sometimes sing the old hymns, and boy, it's got to be the old words with the old melody, not the new you rewritten words, because the old words will still get through. The old words and the melody will still offer comfort in a way that the new words may not. So, SFs, sensors and feelers, the tangible world and the relationships that we are in. And they get linked through story in yet another way. One of the things that SFs do is they tell stories about tangible objects. This was my grandmother's lace tablecloth, and we always use it for Shabbat. This was your, these flowers, the orange flowers and the red leaves, were left to the church. They were from an arrangement that Trish Judd and her sister Barbara Stein used to put in the front of the sanctuary. That's where the arrangement up front comes from. And it takes on more meaning if you know the person in the relationship to which the flowers are connected. This is true when you're talking about creating all sorts of meanings, not just personal family meanings, but this is where relics get their magic for people. This is where spirit bundles are created because they have the story and the object tied together to create the meaning. We have a colleague in our congregation who died not long ago, Pat Reibel. And on the last time I visited her, she made a point of bringing out this beautiful purple knitted shawl, which her friend had given her. And she said, this is a prayer shawl. I don't think we have them in Unitarian Universalism, but my friend knitted it from me, and she said that she prayed the entire time she knitted for my well-being. And when I put it on, I feel her love, and I feel better. Okay? An object imbued with a story, imbued with a relationship, becomes a touchstone for comfort. You know, casserole can have the same effect. If somebody you love brings you a casserole, even if you're not hungry, you're going to have three bites because you love the person who made it. And that three bites might make you feel better. So, when you enter a spirituality that emphasizes living the stories, that nudges you to experience the mystery of the universe and the tangible objects that surround you, it can lead to an intensely personal experience of God. Now, you'll remember when we talked about the intuitive thinkers, one of the quotes we used was about the wonderful, benign indifference of the universe that allowed for all this space and freedom for human beings. Well, we're kind of the flip side of that today. Today, it's not the benign indifference of the universe, it is the personal engagement of the individual and the universe, that sense of love and of care and of mystery, showing up all around you all the time. Well, if you walk around in the world feeling loved, experiencing this story of how the universe loves you and having it show up in prayer shawls and in bread and in the people you talk to, then something interesting sometimes happens. You fill up and you overflow. And all that love has to go somewhere. And for the sensing feelers, it's not likely to go into legislative advocacy. It's going to go into hands-on service, caring action between two people who see each other eye to eye. And so the sensing feelers are the ones who are often part of the care team, bringing casseroles and giving rides. They're among the crew who go down and serve food at the interfaith shelter. They are the ones who notice when someone else is feeling sad. They are the ones who always send thank you notes. They are the ones who check before they bring you that casserole to make sure you can eat green chilies or cheese. They are the ones who give a soul to our community by helping us to care for one another. Now, this is not an easy spiritual path, because it involves a whole lot of other people, and people are messy. People are imperfect. People are sometimes ungrateful. People sometimes don't notice when you're walking your spiritual path of devotion and caring for them as an expression of your own spiritual practice. It is fraught with all of the entanglements of ordinary, emotional human beings. But it is also a path which is incredibly rich in sensory pleasures, because it is the sensing folks who appreciate the well-cooked meal, who appreciate the light being just so on the mountains, who notice the chords and the melodies and the emotional valence of the music that they listen to in the service. In Thomas More's book, The Care of the Soul, he talks about soulful spirituality as embedded in and fed by the details of the world. He describes a way of engaging in the world which revels in the sensuous aspects of our human experience, a way of encountering the world which celebrates relationships and sustains the soul. Now, Unitarian Universalism, historically, at least the Unitarian side of it, has tended more towards the spiritual than towards the soulful historically, and as such has often spoken most clearly to the thinkers in our midst. But we have another side of our tradition, the Universalist side, and they have deep heritage in practices that feed the soul. Over the last 20 years ago, now when I went to divinity school, 20 years ago, they didn't talk about the Universalists at all. And over the last 20 years, I've been fascinated to watch as the Universalists have moved out of the quiet corners and into the mainstream of our faith traditions. I don't think that the charge corpse-cold Unitarian, which was levied against the congregation I served in Cambridge, Massachusetts, some 200 years ago, I don't think that charge pertains in our congregations anymore. We are increasingly colorful and creative and compassionate, hands-on and reverent and joyful. Increasingly, when we gather, we have an intention to feed the heart and the soul as well as the mind and the spirit. In the past two decades, a whole series of practices have spontaneously bubbled up in our congregations. When I went off to divinity school, there were still lots and lots of congregations that did not light a chalice as part of their worship service. The flaming chalice is an image, and the lighting of a chalice in worship is a ritual that spontaneously happened in Unitarian Universalist congregations across the country without anyone anywhere saying, this is something you should do. It just happened, and it persisted because it spoke to many, many people. Well, extinguishing the chalice kind of happened the same way. Water ceremony bubbled up. Flower communion bubbled up. None of these were top-down things that somebody planned. They were an expression of people wanting to be together and celebrate in ways that were tangible and easy to hand on. So we can thank the SFs in our midst, the sensing feelers, for the symbols in our ritual and for our really vivid ritual practices. We can also thank them for the hearing loop and for the large print hymnals and for the many varied kinds of chairs in the sanctuary, which fit different kinds of bodies and have arms so you can lift yourself up if you need to lift yourself up. Now, I am also aware that it is the sensing feelers who eventually will revolt and say we need new chairs. When are we finally going to get around to it? However, we want to thank them today for the work that they've done so far in ensuring that our physical bodies stay comfortable enough that our minds can listen and our hearts can feel what's going on in the room. Those of us who are intuitive thinkers need to be recalled to the sensual joys of the tangible world and to the complex gifts of relationship, which are bread and butter for SF soulfulness. And the sensing feelers in our midst need the wider horizons and the deeper perspective and the forward-thinking vision that inspire and empower the intuitive thinkers who are gathered here. There is space for both of the journeys, the journey of unity and the journey of devotion, within these walls. Soul and spirit need one another, and we need both of them in order to be whole. May it be so.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry with our hearts until we are again.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, namaste, blessed be. Please turn and greet your neighbors.